meeting. But with virtual meetings in mind, Paul and Kate, our secretary, arrange for you all to receive the papers for this meeting well in advance to enable you to have time to formulate any queries or questions you wish to include in our debating. Being very aware of how many virtual meetings you have all attended in the past, Paul and David will give a short resume of their papers and then open up to the committee for their usual discussions. In this way, we hope to have a productive but not too long meeting. Before we commence the meeting, I regret to announce that Paul Tuthill and Ken Pollock have resigned from the committee and will be leaving after this meeting. I thank them both for their contribution to discussions and decision-making and of their support of the Malvern Hills AONB. My personal thanks to Ken for his support whilst he was a vice chairman, for his wise counsel and support when I called upon him from time to time for advice. Thank you both, and we wish you all the best for the future. Now, if we can continue then with our first item on the agenda, which is apologies.
Yes, we've had apologies from Hazel McDowell and Duncan Bridges.
Thank you. Declarations of interest. Have we got any declarations of interest to declare?
Yes, Chairman. Farm and work in the south end of the Malvern Hills and own part of the land in the AONB.
Thank you, James. Any other declarations? Could we then have confirmation of the minutes of the previous meeting? Kate had sent those all out to you. And can I have a proposer and a seconder that they are correct and can be signed at a later date? Yes, John and Richard and everyone is in agreement. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Then we can go straight on to item 4 on the agenda. Advising and supporting landowners and managers in a protected landscape. And I'll hand over to Paul to give us the information that we require for discussion on this item.
Okay, well, good morning, everyone. Nice to see you. Very briefly, there are two parts to this paper, both indicative, I think, of a move towards greater involvement from protected landscape teams in terms of supporting land owners and managers in both the national parks and the AONBs in this country. So the first part just tells you a little bit about some ELM environmental land management advocacy work, which DEFRA specifically funded in each of the AONBs and national parks from about October last year. That was quite a short piece of work, and the report just tells you how we use that funding. And the second part of the paper is about the Farming in Protected Landscapes program. That's a program we're still waiting at this stage to hear a bit more about. But as you will read, it's been flagged up in the agricultural transition plan and again indicates the government's intention to better support, I think, landowners and managers in the AONB as we move towards this new environmental land management scheme. So I think that's enough for me. I'm very happy to take any questions or comments.
No. James, have you got anything you wish to say? You're muted, Jack.
I just managed to unmute myself. No, I think it's very timeous. I mean, as we and probably NFU members are anxiously waiting to see what schemes are going to be put forward, because our funding from grants is going to disappear. So I think it's a very good opportunity for the AONB to sort of step in and help us when we know exactly what we're going to get paid for doing in the future. And there's going to be a trade-off. There's a lot of access in the AONB, of course, and we're all wondering how much more will be required and just indeed how it's going to work in practice. So we're all, and I'm sure NFU are just the same, we're all sort of anxiously wondering what we should do. So I think you've got in quite early, Paul, and that this will be, you know, there will be people who will definitely want to collaborate, because I think it'll end up with them getting more support, financial support. So thank you.
Sarah, have you got anything you'd like to add?
I think James has covered it all really well, really, actually, that the issue at the moment is that we're still waiting on more detail on what the scheme will actually, how it will be structured, what the payments will be, and how farmers actually go forward and engage with it. I think what Paul's put together here is really positive in that it sets out what we know so far about how ELM will work in protected landscapes. And you've got two sort of really positive strands to it. And you've got potential support for farmers operating in the area, but also a bit of an acknowledgement that there needs to be more investment in the access infrastructure, particularly as more people are encouraged to access the outdoors. And, definitely something we'd welcome, because, you know, we've seen farmers struggling really to manage access over the last sort of 12, 18 months.
Yes, I can understand that. Are there any other questions or queries? Oh, John Rain.
Thank you, Chair. The sentence that surprised, perhaps disappointed me in Paul's paper on this was paragraph 12. We had no knowledge of this programme before it was published. That seems a surprise that AOMBs, you know, haven't been party to at least what's been talked about and, as it were, developed. Was that, do you think, oversight, or is it just that the thing has been prepared at pretty short notice and there was no time for discussion with partners?
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting one. I think it's fair to say that there has been really good dialogue between the National Association for AOMBs and civil servants in DEFRA, really over a period of many years now, as we've sort of sought to get better at delivering sort of government's agenda. The notification in the agricultural transition plan was the specific thing that sort of came a little bit out of the blue for us. And I'm, because I've not been party to those sort of conversations at a higher level, I'm not exactly sure what the cause of that was, or whether it was a timing issue, as you say, and sort of a something that came in quite last minute. But I think it is fair to say that generally the dialogue has been quite good. And I think we DEFRA see us, the sort of AOMB network, as a, you know, as an important way of delivering its agenda, or helping to deliver its agenda within these sorts of protected landscapes.
Ken would like to say something.
Thank you very much, Chairman. Yes, a couple of points. If I can preface it by saying I have absolutely no criticism at all of what has been written in this paper by Paul and others. And I think it's entirely sensible what they're suggesting in the circumstances. Now, I have to declare an interest here, because I used to have about 5 acres in Great Whitley, and I received money from the Rural Payments Agency. Just as an aside, it was very steep. And the RPA worked on the basis of a flat area, as if it was flat. So we got paid less than we would have done if they'd recognised the fact it was very steep. Uh-huh. That's trivial, because the amount of money was trivial. On the other hand, there are two things that I think are significant in this particular area. One, what happens after you've done it, Paul, at the end of your third year? So what happens in year four?
Yeah.
And what happens on the other side of the delineation of the ONB? And James will know this, because he said part of his land is within the ONB and part's not. Mm-hmm. At the moment, everybody is paid according to their acreage owned. And that stays the same year by year. Once this ELMS scheme is in, I have no idea how you get paid after you have done some of the very valuable work you talked about. So once it's done, does everybody come back and inspect the following year and make sure you carry it out doing the same careful management of your soil? Do they sample across every acre that you own to make sure that you're worthy of the same payment? You still own it. So on the old system, however flawed, it was very clear. And I say this as a conservative, and this government is conservative, and it's brought in this idea of an environmental land management scheme, and they haven't sorted out what they're going to do yet. And I haven't got the slightest idea how year by year they decide how much James and others get paid for what they're doing. And certainly there's nothing to that effect within Paul's otherwise very good paper. Sorry about that, a bit negative, but there we are.
Oh, and then James.
Yes, please, James first.
You're muted, James. James, you're muted.
Ken's absolutely right. I mean, we know we're going to get a lot less, and we don't know at all how it's going to be assessed as we go along. I mean, I would say, and the NFU will have the same experience, that anybody who receives grants at the moment for the high level stewardship scheme or other schemes does get inspected by the Royal Payments Agency. So there is a sort of system in place for looking at people. So that will presumably be extended, but it's a very uncertain time. I mean, the one thing I would say, given, you know, that farmers will want to stay in business, is there will be pressure on the OMB as people want to put up, you know, camping huts or you know, there'll be infrastructure that farmers will want to put in place to generate more income, as it were, you know, like caravan sites and all that. So that'll be a separate thing, which will not be, will be outside the grant system. But I think you must expect farmers will want to go more commercial with, you know, converting barns and stuff like that. But that's outside the scope of what Paul's been covering. So that's the answer.
Thank you, James. Sarah would like to say something.
Yeah, I was going to say that I think around the payments, we still don't have a lot of the information that we would need. We've seen some payment rates for the sustainable farming incentive element of ELM, some proposed payment rates, and they work on areas of hedgerow or areas of watercourse buffered, etc. So they give you a sort of a payment range for activities and for carrying out farming according to standards. I think we as the NFU have said that those sort of proposed payment rates are on the low side, particularly given that we know we're going to be losing the basic payment scheme support. So there is a concern there that, you know, that it's making sure that this package actually covers the costs of management. And that has been one of the themes all the way through this ELM development, is that, you know, there's been a lot of focus on habitat creation, but when you come to landscapes, particularly like Malvern, where you are looking at maintenance of an existing high quality landscape, that's where we have some concerns, that particularly for upland farmers who are maintaining landscape assets, how do they fit into ELM? Because and the money seems to be more on habitat creation. So there's still an awful lot of issues to work through. And in terms of verification that these standards are met, what we're hearing back from DEFRA is that they want it to be much more straightforward than what they've had in the past, because I think a farmer who's been through a full agri-environment inspection will tell you that it's been, you know, it's a very involved process where we'd be looking down to the last sort of inch of your 6 meter margin just under 6 meter, or is it over 6 meter? So they can get, you know, very, very detailed. And I think DEFRA wanted to move away from that, because if a farmer was found that, you know, he wasn't quite hitting that 6 meter, then there would be a big recovery and penalty regime imposed. So they want to move away from that. They want to have it to be more flexible, but we still don't have an answer really as going forward, how we're going to verify the maintenance of existing landscapes.
Thank you, Sarah. Can I just ask, sort of apropos of not being a landowner or anything like that, how do you cope with prompt payments? Do you get prompt payments on these special support that you get, or is it something that we get in arrears? I'm never quite certain. With the Malvern Hills Trust, I know we have great difficulty in getting money for promised money. It seems to come very, very late. Is the same thing happening with landowners?
Yeah, it's an ongoing problem that, yes, it's payments in arrears, and payment windows are very long, and it would depend on the status of your agreement as to whether there's an issue, whether it's been inspected. If you have an inspection, then, you know, we've had farmers who are waiting, you know, years for payments rather than months. So it's an acknowledged issue with the current system. But hopefully the new system going forward will, you know, they will address that lag between actually doing the work and the payments. And that's something that DEFRA have flagged up that they are wanting to look at.
Oh, well, that's good. That's a positive. Paul?
Yeah, I don't think I can add too much to what others have said. Clearly, there is still much uncertainty around. I mean, I think many will be aware that there are a series of, I think now 60 tests and trials going on. I think the intention is that DEFRA will also run a national pilot prior to sort of implementing the full scheme itself from about 2024. I think that's right. So hopefully, you know, there's a lot of work to be done between now and then to sort of proof all of this and to work out the details and work out the sort of systems around payments and all the rest of it. But yeah, clearly there's a lot of uncertainty at the moment. I mean, one final point perhaps for me in terms of how we're trying to engage with owners and support owners more within the context of the AOMB is that I think we're increasingly looking to work with those sort of clusters or groups of farmers and landowners. And we've, as many of you will know, we've been running a facilitation fund, a group of now about 15 or so owners and managers down in the sort of southwest part of the AOMB, and that includes James, East Norland and other holdings close by. And then, as this report intimates, in the north of the AOMB, we've just really done some work with a group of about 10 landowners now covering about 1,000 hectares. And I'm very keen that we try and support and work with that group of as well. So that move towards more clustered working, I think, fits really nicely with what I think is going to be the second tier of the new land management scheme, which is about collaboration, trying to achieve more in terms of land management and benefits to nature through group working, not just individually in the way we might have done in the past. So hopefully that's, you know, that's a positive thing. And I think generally farmers and land managers like that sense of sort of working together and you know, knowing what other people are up to and how what they do can benefit the wider area. So I hope that's a direction of travel that continues.
Thank you, Paul. Has anyone else anything they would like to contribute? Now, Richard.
Well, no one's commented really on element B, but I must say to Paul, I thought this was a very entertaining sketch of all the possibilities, but it's completely bedeviled by the same point made earlier that things like rangers and building up outreach work, etc., is bedeviled by the 3-year cap. I mean, it doesn't seem a great deal point discussing really any of it really until we're clearer as to what actually will be allowed, and then we can discuss it.
Okay, I mean, just to be clear, so yes, the 3-year program is obviously to try and help us support and advise in this transitional period to work with owners. Obviously, once we're into the environmental land management scheme, that will be the scheme that sort of continues into the future and hopefully supports owners and managers from there on. So, but yes, you know, again, we do need that more information. I was hoping today perhaps to be able to give you a bit more information about the 3-year farming in protected landscapes program specifically, but that isn't available at this time.
Thank you, Paul. Jeremy.
I'd just like to comment. Most of my interest involved planning, and in fact, seeing how the AOMB engages with the planning authorities, we've had a very, very good example with some new proposed buildings, which are right in the centre of the AOMB. However, there are some unfortunate things that actually fall outside the planning rulebook, and the desires of the AOMB, the actual advice, does not seem to be getting through. Let me just show you this. If I can get that to be full screen. No. You don't want pictures of my children. I don't know whether you can see this image here of a fence. Which has actually gone around a cottage, and the cottage is a bridge cottage on the right in the centre of the AOMB. And it's, there is a new, what can I say, a new fashion for these very, very large and palisade fences. And they have a significant visual impact on the significant influence on the landscape and the built environment. New owners have moved in at the for Castle Morton, we actually have a welcome pack which we publish to all of the new people. And it would be very interesting to have some guidance and links to the advice that the AOMB can offer that might prevent some of the unfortunate effects of developments like this. Okay.
Thank you, Jeremy. Paul, did you want to reply to that?
Well, I wasn't able to see any image, but I have a picture in my mind's eye. I think, on that latter point, we did some years ago produce a leaflet which we circulated to estate agents and solicitors locally, which was a sort of welcome to the AOMB leaflet for new, you know, purchases of new land and property in the area. And that was one that sought to just notify them that, you know, that they are in an AOMB and they're fortunate to be so, but also to give them a bit of a heads up that, you know, guidance exists and we can help. They can, you know, certain things might apply in AOMBs that don't apply outside. So we have tried to make some moves in that direction. We could probably look at breathing a bit of new life into this, but yeah, there's no accounting for taste, as the saying goes. And I mean, some of these things we can sort of do something about. And sometimes because of the way permitted development and so on works, we're not in a position to do much about. But
yeah, very unfortunate, that one.
Okay.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to contribute?
Chairman, I was just going to make another comment.
Certainly, yeah.
I've obviously said I could well have been taken to being very negative before, and I don't want to give that impression. Some of you may know that I used to produce the television farming programme, and I once remember interviewing the Minister of Agriculture, Michael Jopling, I think it was, in a field in the Lake District. And I presented him with the problem because they said they were going to introduce a new form of grant for certain areas within the Lake District. So I said to him, well, you mean if I have land here where we're standing, I get the money, but on the other side of that hedge, you do not get it. And he said, yes. Well, that was obvious. Lines on maps make differences. On one side, you may get support. On the other side, you don't. And I'm absolutely not saying that is wrong. It's obviously right. It has to happen. It's awkward. James will know some of his land might benefit from the OMB. Other parts of his land will not. But that's neither here nor there. You have to accept that kind of difficulty. And Michael Jopling was 100% right. I'm glad I asked him the question because I've got a very clear answer. Lines on maps matter.
Thank you, Ken. Is there anything else anyone would like to comment about? No. Well, thank you, Paul, for this paper. It's proving very interesting. And I think it's a little bit of watch this space, isn't it? And we will wait to hear what happens in the perhaps near future or distant future, depending on how things go. But thank you very much. Can we then, if there's nothing else to be discussed on that, can we move then to item 5 on the agenda, which is the National Arts Strategy? And I think David is going to take us through this.
Yes, I am. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I guess this is about a bit of a different approach to the issues of our time, climate change, health and well-being, and nature conservation. A lot of the projects we do at the AOMB tend to be science, or dare I say pseudoscience, in that they're data-led, they're evidence-based, they're about the head. What this arts strategy is more about is an emotional response to things, engaging the heart. And I think it goes back to the sort of David Attenborough point that what you don't know about, you don't care about, what you don't care about, you don't love, and what you don't love, you don't want to conserve or keep. So the National Association of AOMBs have picked up this idea and produced a national arts strategy. It's just 48 pages long, which certainly gave me an emotional response when I started to read it. And what you see before you in the 7 pages in the paper is their summary of that national strategy. Now, I guess what I'm going to try and do is produce a summary of that summary. And where I'd start is by saying that a lot of government reports, such as the Glover Review, and indeed the AOMB's National Association's Colchester Declaration, are trying to widen the appeal of AONBs to a broader and more diverse audience, create deeper connections with people, with nature, and hopefully inspire a bit of behavioural change. Now, the arts traditionally are quite good at that sort of thing. And you can't do this without having resources and a bit of money. So the National Association have put together this strategy, and they will go to the people with money, which is largely Arts Council England. And if they can go with this strategy saying that all the AONBs have agreed to it and think it's a good idea, then hopefully there will be a funding stream distinctly for landscapes, AONBs, possibly national parks as well, that we can then tap into in order to promote the sorts of things that we as an AONB, as a JAC, are keen on promoting. So that's really it. It's a bit of a, it's a sprat to catch a mackerel, I guess, if we are happy with this as a general sense of direction. If we can say so, we can return that back to the National Association, who can then go and knock on the door of Arts Council England, and who knows what might happen.
Thank you, David. I think that's it. Thank you. Have we got any questions or queries on this? Bronwyn.
Yeah, thank you. I thought this was very interesting and something that we should support to adopt it. Something, John Rain probably knows more than I do at district level, that we have been engaged with West Midlands Culture Response Unit to try and seek to develop our area for visitors and enhance it. And the one activity that we did recently was a commission with the musical artist Andy Garby. We did Spring Calling, which was linked to the equinox. And I think as part of it, it mentions that if it's guided by specific events, that's something that we can take forward. So certainly within Malvern Hills ANOB, I think this is something that if they're able to get the strategy moving on it, we could develop alongside partners. Thank you.
Thank you, Bronwyn. Are there any other questions? I have got, oh yes, but Helen.
Yes, thank you, Gwyneth. Artistic idea. In October this year, the Grayson Perry has his exhibition coming to Hereford Museum, and it's called The Vanity of Small Differences. Well, in alongside that they've asked for people to submit artworks to be displayed alongside this, and I've sort of taken it on board, and one of the things is in approaching the art college to do an artwork concerning the rivers, because of the phosphates that are in the Hereford rivers, a real problem. That if there was an artwork displaying that and highlighting it. And the same could be done for the hills, for areas of, if the schools were to come on board and actually produce something that could be seen by the public. I just throw that out.
Thank you, Helen. I can see David smiling there. I'm waiting for him to say poetry in a moment.
Well, as you know, we have done a bit of poetry. Well, everything we do is poetic. But there is actually a final point that I would like to make is that we have tried various arts projects, and personally, I find them quite difficult to manage. They're not like planting trees or producing widgets. The product is actually really difficult to define. And so my plea goes out to anybody who's got experience of running arts projects. Could they please just pick up the phone and give me a call, because I'm not very good at it and ignorant, but willing to learn.
Thank you, David. Can I just, oh, James has got something.
David, I don't think running music festivals counts as art, really, but it does bring in a huge number of people to the ONB. So I'm happy to talk about that. But when the Big Chill was at Easter, they definitely put up art installations to sort of, you know, amongst the trees and stuff. So I think they do work. And I mean, I have a sort of vision of a sort of a Gormley, statue on the top of it at some point, because you know, that would really, I'm sure that would really bring people in, you know, and the angel of the Malvern Hills, you know, that would be low maintenance and catch the eye. I mean, it would probably need planning permission, which it wouldn't get, but you know.
Well, it could be very useful.
Our monument doesn't do it, but yeah, that sort of thing.
It could be very useful if you disguised it as a 5G mast as well. So practical and useful.
Especially for Eastnor.
One moment, Ken would like to say something.
Indeed, thank you, Chairman. On that score, we did have a Anthony Gormley sculpture in the Whitley Court grounds, but they were all removed after a while, I'm afraid. I just had a couple of technical queries for David, because I didn't really understand it. We see the term capital D stroke deaf, and I don't know what that means. I've got a deaf daughter, but I'm not familiar with that term. And also BAMER, we're all told not to use the BAME mead anywhere because it lumps everybody together in one lump. But then you've added an R to it as well, and I don't know what that means. The final point is that at the SWDP meeting on Wednesday, we were told to sort of remove the term AONB and use the term, which I think Mr. Glover suggested, national landscapes. But I'm not sure that had been accepted. SWDP has changed everything to say national landscapes. That was supposed to embrace AONBs and national parks. But my feeling was that it hadn't actually been officially accepted. So I just wonder whether you could answer any of those points, please.
Thank you.
Well, a general point that, like you, I'm forever tripping up over modern terminology. With BAMER, the R, I think, refers to refugees in this case. So, yes, it's really helpful. In terms of the national landscape, I think, Paul, I'm right in saying that hasn't been accepted as a term, and we are still an AONB.
Yes, that's right. I mean, I wasn't aware of that development, Ken. I mean, obviously the SWDPR for the South Worcestershire area will include a small area of the Cotswolds as well. And as you probably all know, the Cotswolds really have labelled themselves a national landscape, refer to themselves as the Cotswolds National Landscape rather than AONB. So I wonder if the drive for changing towards national landscape comes from that direction. But now you've made me aware of that, Ken, I'll probably pick up the phone to one of the strategic officers and have a chat about that, because it's...
I didn't think it was appropriate for me to challenge it on Wednesday because I knew nothing about it, but it struck me as being a bit premature. The D-stroke deaf thing, what's that mean?
I was hoping you wouldn't re-ask that question.
I'm sorry.
I've got a clue what it means. It's not, they're not my words, actually. So... I'll find out and let you know.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Might I just ask a question of our landowners? How do you feel about this influx of more people coming into the countryside? And how would you work within this arts in the landscape within your land? Would this present problems for you? Maybe Sarah or James would like to answer. James.
Sarah first.
Okay. I think it depends totally on your business and where you are and the sort of nature of your sort of geography of your landholding, really. We've seen all sorts of problems over the last 12 months that we haven't had before, around, you know, littering, dogs, barbecues, you know, the whole range really of issues. I think the key thing going forward is that we put appropriate investment into managing the infrastructure that we have, and if we're going to, you know, encourage additional people to come and enjoy the countryside, which is great, it's making sure that they've got the information and the advice that they need to to make that visit. And we've done a lot of work nationally on the refresh of the Countryside Code. And there are various different sort of media campaigns going on, particularly around the issue of dogs at the moment and livestock worrying, and just being out and about with your dog. And we've partnered up with other organisations on that. So there's an awful lot more to do. We do want to encourage people to enjoy the countryside. And I think there's potential as we learn more about ELM and other sources of funding come into the countryside, there's probably potential to build on that that infrastructure and those opportunities. But I think the last 12 months has really been about sort of coping with this change. And for some farmers in some locations, it has been quite a dramatic change.
Thank you. James?
I think that's the issue. I mean, we've certainly had a lot more access in our park, which is generally open, and it is obvious that a bit of more management is needed. But we've got the commercial resources to address that there, but elsewhere not. So I agree with Sarah. I mean, I think that if the government is going to give farmers money, I think they're possibly going to ask for better access, and the two will be linked. Sorry, you're muted. I think you're muted. Gwyneth, I can't hear you.
Here we are. Sorry, wrong button there. Okay. The reason I asked this was because I know that David is very keen on using art within the countryside. And I was wondering how you would work that, David, with the landowners. Have you got any ideas? I know in the area that I work in, we've got a lot of footpaths. And one of the suggestions is that people go out and walk these footpaths and then perhaps take photographs or write a poem or do a painting and introduce something in the way of arts that way. And I was wondering whether, David, you've got any ideas like this that would help.
Well, I do have ideas, and I guess arts projects are in two categories. There are those that might be more ephemeral and those that are more permanent. The Gormley sculpture would be permanent. Writing a poem about a gatepost is more ephemeral. And I think I would start probably with the more ephemeral means of doing this, movement in the landscape, poetry, those sorts of things, painting wildflowers, because we're interested in meadows. Those sorts of things would be a great introduction to this before attempting to put up a Gormley statue.
Thank you. Are there any other... Richard would like to say something.
Yes, the antithesis of a Gormley statue is something I suggested about a decade ago, and even I had forgotten about it until now. And that was, probably some of you know, in the Forest of Dean, there is a geology map, which is horizontal. Have you ever seen this?
Yes.
It's actually a depiction of the geology of the area, so the geology of the OMB, on a planimetric map. So it's a mosaic, and it's made up of the constituent rocks where they're hard enough. So it forms a flat surface. Now, I think that's both very solid, very permanent. It's interesting. And I suppose it would need planning permission, but I think that would still remain an excellent art installation. One can commission a sculptor to do it. I mean, a peripheral point is that, as we all know, the Morvan's Ridge has been suffering considerably over the last 12 months from access. And the geologists amongst us have noted the rate of footpath erosion on places like Pinnacle Hill and Black Hill, and even up above the Dingle. So I think that if we do have anything like a quasi-permanent installation, we somehow need to follow something which was in the OMB management plan, I think, whether it's in the last one, I can't remember, of trying to site these things, not on the Morvan's Ridge, but somewhere else in the OMB, to try and diversify the visitor pressure.
Thank you.
Anyway, I'll leave it at that. My 10-yearly promotion of this idea I've now made, and hope it's not another 10 years before anything happens. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We've been asked to adopt the Arts in the Landscape strategy and support participation and support the principle of using arts to help join at the climate change. Now, can I have your idea? Are you happy to go along with this? Could I have a proposer and a seconder that we agree to this? Jeremy? Yes, and James? I think we're all in agreement. Thank you. We're all in agreement. And please, if you have any suggestions, please contact David. He's very approachable and will be very keen to take you on board and get you to write poetry or paint pictures. You'll find yourself engaged, I promise you. Thank you very much. And if we can move then on to item 6 on the agenda, which is the budget.
Okay, that's me again, and you
very
will all
serious
be
serious now. We are.
You're all very familiar with this, the look of this sort of paper that traditionally appears at the April meeting. A couple of corrections, if I may. First of all, at the bottom of page 17, I've mentioned Gloucestershire County Council's contribution has been £600. It's actually gone up to £630. Just ought to record that change, just in case anyone tells me off for not having done so. In paragraph 7, on reading through the paper last night, I realised that there's a not in there, an NOT, which shouldn't be there. And this is really around the replacement or not of our support officer in the team, which we haven't had for more than 12 months now. And just to be clear that the intention, certainly in the very short term, is that we continue not to have a support officer for the reasons mentioned. In terms of the overall budget, it's very much a case of as you were. DEFRA have rather belatedly but announced that our funding package for next year for our core funding is exactly for the current financial year, our funding is exactly the same as it was last year. There's been no change in the local authority contributions from last year, other than the extra £30 that I've just mentioned coming from Gloucestershire County Council. So in terms of the overall budget picture, it's, as I say, very much a case of as you were. The work priorities in paragraph 8, apologies, myself and David and Karen in the team have met recently to add some flesh to the bones of the work programme, but what you've got there is really just a few key bullet points about what we expect to be spending our time doing over the course of the next sort of 11 to 12 months or so. I'm happy to take any questions.
Are there any questions? Richard again?
I was pleased to see, if I got this right, the Sustainable Development Fund is still running for next year. Because on page 3 of the agenda, 3 lines from the bottom in the first item, it talks about the former SDF. I should have mentioned it at the time.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does.
Yes.
Page 3,
yes.
3 lines up.
That's my mistake, sorry. Yes.
What did you mean to say?
There is still an SDF running this year. A lot of different AOMB teams have done different things with SDF over the years. Yeah. Some don't run SDF programs at all anymore. Some do, but don't call it SDF anymore. They call it a Cotswold conservation pot or whatever it is. So there is still a funding mechanism for grants for SDF projects, and we are looking to continue that this year. Yes, apologies for that mistake.
I'm speaking entirely out of self-interest.
Indeed, take that as a given, Dick, that's fine.
Thank you.
Are there any questions for Paul? May I just say before Ken comes in that I am amazed at the amount of effort and work that goes into this and what we get for a very small pot of money. And I have to commend the officers for this because they do a tremendous amount of work on for a very small amount of money. We go to Ken and then to John Rain. Ken?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I've been on this committee a long time and I just want to demonstrate my ignorance, which won't surprise anybody. Why is it that Herefordshire pays more than Worcestershire? What's the basis for the payment?
So there's a very old funding formula, which was around, I'll tell you how old it is, because it was around when I joined the team. It may even have been around when David joined the team. I'm not sure. But it, essentially, there's a calculation based on the size of the area within that's designated as A and B. And I think something like 55% or so of the A and B is in Herefordshire. So it's essentially based on size of the area, but I believe that the population has a role to play in that as well. Don't ask me for the details. No one, it seems, has wanted to go near the funding formula for a while, but that's essentially how it works.
Thank you, Ken.
In other words, it's a bit like the Barnett formula for Scotland, is it?
Yeah, very much so.
Very
probably, yeah, careful, probably slightly less complicated, but perhaps not too much. So
let's not be that controversial.
Don't highlight it for Herefordshire, will you?
Okay. Is there someone else who wanted to make a comment on this budget? John Ring. Off you go, John.
Thank you. Yeah, this is a bit of an annual from me. The issue of the voluntary contributions, which I'm always pleased to see. I do think it's great that some parish councils are contributing some quite significantly to their AAMB and recognise the great work that's done for their benefit and parishioners' benefit. But I think I'd like to be reassured that we are promoting the AOMB to all parish councils in our area regularly, so annually, and I think I've said this before, probably ideally in the sort of October, November time as they're beginning to gear up to preparing their next year's budget. And I think it's important that all parish councils that, you know, significantly involve AOMB land should know what other parishes are doing. So I think it should be transparent, and that might actually encourage a few more to respect their potential to support the AMB in their area. But can I, as well as sort of opening that chestnut again, can I ask the question whether in preparing our budget, the unit actually makes a direct approach to the principal councils, Herefordshire, Worcestershire, Malvern Hills, Forest of Dean and Gloucestershire, and actually asks for money? Because I think, I mean, Malvern Hills District Council, I know, has been 11,000 for probably 6 years now. It went from 14,000, if I remember rightly, you know, in a period of cuts, and it's been 11,000 ever since. Malvern Hills puts its own budget up by inflation every year, as does pretty well every organisation. And it just concerns me really that if we're not asking, we're probably getting, and I've seen it happen at West Malvern Parish Council, the same figure just dropped into last year's figure and dropped into the new draft budget. And I think we're possibly missing a trick to, you know, be a bit more assertive of the need for the AOMB to keep up with inflation at least. Thank you, Chair.
Paul, would you like to?
Okay, well, on the first of those points, the parish councils and their contributions, I mean, we certainly do send the annual review of the partnership's work when it's produced to every one of the parish councils that have land within the AOMB. And as part of that correspondence, I do ask the question every year about whether parish councils would like to make a voluntary contribution. And thereafter, I have been known to harass and harangue certain parish councils who might have indicated a willingness to support but actually haven't sent any through to make sure that they do so. So we do try, we do certainly have that annual correspondence as a minimum with the parish councils and look to, you know, obviously we work with some more than others depending on what's going on in any one year, but that does happen. On the second point, I mean, the contributions that we get, I think it's fair to say that I don't, it's seen as a rolling commitment, I think, and Rachel might want to come in terms of the Worcestershire County Council contribution to the AOMB, but I think the figures that come over are sort of rolling figures, the same each year. 2, maybe even 3 years ago, I did write to the various local authority funding partners to explain that we have had a real terms reduction over a period of, well, a considerable number of years now. And I raised the sort of possibility that people might want to consider recognizing that and accounting for inflation in the contributions that we received, but nothing back was forthcoming. So I haven't dared to try and open that can of worms again since then, but I certainly recognize the point. And we, as John says, we have been in a process or in a period of having a flat settlement for a very considerable number of years now, and obviously that has an impact in terms of the inflationary value. But Rachel, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
Thanks, Paul. I think we did discuss it within the last year again at the steering group meeting, didn't we? And or am I? Perhaps it is longer ago than that. Perhaps it is 3 or 4 years. But I think there was talk of maybe writing again to the contributing local authorities to raise that question. Perhaps it would be appropriate to do that. Yeah, obviously there's elections coming up. Maybe it would be appropriate to do that again in the autumn as we're approaching budget setting for next year. But obviously that would, that would be a decision for the JAC.
I think just to say one issue, of course, is that for many local authorities, it's not just about a contribution to the Malvern Hills AOMB. So Gloucestershire County Council, for example, contribute to the Cotswolds, shall I call it National Landscape rather than AOMB. They also contribute to the Wye Valley AOMB. They also contribute to our AOMB. So I think sort of the purse, that those who hold the purse strings are very aware of the fact that it's not just a case of giving a bit more money to one AOMB. It might be, you know, to in the interest of fairness that they need to do the same for a number of AOMBs they support. And obviously that has more significant implications. But
are there any other questions or queries? Has anyone anything they wish to say? We've noted the budget and we've commented on it. And we look forward to seeing the money wisely spent for the coming year. Thank you very much, Paul. Perhaps then we can go on to item 7 on the agenda, which is the Sustainable Development Fund, Richard, and a report from David Armitage.
Okay, thank you very much. It's been a thin year of it, obviously, because the Sustainable Development Fund tends to be community-led, people-led, and with all the fear of contagion, not much has been forthcoming. However, thank you very much to the Earth Heritage Trust, that's Dick and particularly John Payne, who've managed to muster their volunteers to once again go forth and maintain geological sites within the area. That's £1,500, item 235 on the table. Another interesting project that's going ahead this year as well is the reintroduction of the pearl bordered fritillary, which is number 239 on the table. We're very grateful to estates like Eastnor, who are very happy to have this reintroduced. And actually, with sort of minimal management, it makes the habitat so much better for these creatures. And we're preparing to import with Butterfly Conservation, who are leading on this, caterpillars from places like US Harold in order to reintroduce them onto the hills this year. And then the final project that I thought I might bring to your attention, this is about that emotional engagement that I talked about in the art strategy, is the metal detectorist display. We have around our area been having a person with a metal detector, but he's no ordinary person. He has a local business and he is very keen on measuring things. He measures statues for all the international museums, so they get very accurate descriptions of what they've got. He's a real technology freak, but also very good on his local history. And he's been going around the parish that I live in, Maithen, and digging up the most extraordinary things. A lot of it is money, a lot of it is coinage, but the depth of history that that represents is extraordinary. For example, he's been finding a lot of the Charles minted shillings that were minted just before the Battle of Worcester to pay the troops that were going to go into battle. And of course, the Royalists lost that battle. Everybody fled. And the last thing he wanted to be found with was Worcester minted Charles shillings. So they chucked them out, and we found great hoards of, well, no, I exaggerate slightly, but quite a few of them littered through the fields of Maytham. And on top of that, we found Venetian coins, which we weren't expecting. These come from a time in the Wars of the Roses where the currency was deeply was unstable. And so there was effectively a euro operating within this area, which were these Venetian coins, which had pictures of the Doge and the lions of Venice on the back of them. What are we going to do with these? Well, we're going to produce a little display that may go into the hall and do a series of talks about them. But it is, to me, an extraordinary sort of depth of history that's sitting maybe only 2 or 3 inches beneath the grass. No doubt it'll be the beautiful meadows that we're trying to restore that we'll have to dig up in order to get the coins out. So there we are. That's the sorts of things we've been getting up to with the Sustainable Development Fund this year.
Thank you, David. Are there any questions or comments? Jeremy would like to ask something.
Yes, the History Girls and the BCH History Project put forward the idea that they would actually document some of the history, particularly the lockdown stories. And in fact, nothing happened. So in fact, what they're doing is they've actually asked and put out a request for imagery which will be created into a fabric collage which will be installed in the newly developed and the newly refurbished Castle Morton Parish Hall. That is due to be opened certainly probably by June, and we hope that this large, shall I say tapestry? I don't think it's a tapestry, will actually feature in there on the wall. So that is making history, and your art as well.
Excellent. It is, yes.
Excellent. Thank you. Are there any other questions or queries? John Rain would like to say something.
Ask a question, if I may, Chair. Yes. It's just pure curiosity, but item 240, meat marketing, it's only £160, but can David explain what meat marketing is doing in the Sustainable Development Fund?
Well, if you probably had a copy of All About the Hills, which is a local magazine that came through. And just before Christmas, there was a picture of a sheep grazing on the hill with the background of Malvern Priory sitting in it. The idea here was that we were working with a local butcher in order to try and promote, don't eat turkey at Christmas, eat Malvern lamb. And we ran that, effectively the money paid for that advert and a bit further marketing to try and add a bit of value to the meat that's coming off the hill. So yeah, a small amount of money, and that's what it was about.
Thank you. Are there any other questions or queries? And don't forget, if you have anything that you think would be suitable for the Sustainable Development Fund, to get in touch with David, and he will no doubt be able to point you in the right direction. Thank you very much, David, for that. We can then go on to item 8 on the agenda, which is information, to note the items of information. Do we need to go down through this? Paul, do you want to just quickly go through this, or are we just happy to see it as it is?
I don't think I need to. If anyone wants to ask any questions about any of the reported items, I'm happy to take them, or David will.
Are there any questions? Ken has a question.
RP4, the revision of the South West Development Plan is going on now, and I just wonder whether the information you're aiming to supply under recreational impacts is with them or not, because there was a meeting on Wednesday about this, and they hope to publish it in the autumn, early autumn. So perhaps you'll give me an update on how much information you've passed through this already.
Yeah, sure. So we did some visitor survey work for that project at the end of December, and I believe the surveyors are actually out on the ground now doing a further 2 weeks of collection. We have been liaising closely with Fred Davis on the SWDPR team. And yes, we're confident that the results from that work will be through and fed into the review process in time. And we have been liaising closely with Fred on that. So he's happy. I think there's been a slight delay to the process because of COVID, and we've sort of tried to make use of that with the survey work we've been doing.
You're absolutely right. It's been put off by about a year. Quite right. I'm glad to hear that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Helen Leanson would like to ask something, and then Richard.
I just want to say RP6, the viaduct appeal, it's very, very disappointing and frustrating and everything else. And hopefully it's not the end of the story. But
yeah.
Thank you, Helen. Richard.
On TP2, Paul, are you in touch with a good app developer, the Colwall footpath item?
I will let David take that one, if I may.
Yes, we are, and both you and I know him. Mike Brooks the person we've got in mind to do it, and he's already signed up.
Brilliant.
Anything else anyone wishes to query on that? No? Right, then we go on to what I find very interesting, the verbal reports from partners. Now, shall we go straight round? I'll go straight round the list, if you like. I start with John Rain. Have you anything that you want to add to our list? I'll go straight down the list.
No, I've said it already, Chair. That was my point about the financial contributions.
Right, thank you. Bronwyn, have you anything that you wish to mention at this stage?
No, I'm fine, thank you, Chair.
Right. I don't think we've got... No, we haven't. Jeremy?
Not a lot to report, apart from a rather annoying delay on the improvements and developments for Castle Morton Parish Hall, where the bridge section proved to be very difficult to actually do. But they've now found some new builders who've taken over, and hopefully that will be completed in June.
Good. We look forward to seeing it. Thank you very much. Helen Leanson, have you anything you wish to contribute to this?
No, thank you very much, except could I bang a drum, please?
Certainly.
I'm masterminding. It'll be the Herefordshire Here Youth Can Conference, which is July 2022. And we have a venue, Castle Green, and it's going to be hopefully a major day conference for all the youth, the young of Herefordshire, to get excited, energized and entertained. And so I shall be calling on businesses, on everyone involved in especially work and jobs and apprenticeships and everything to contribute. And at this stage, ideas will be fantastic, and I shall bang on about it.
Thank you, Helen. Well, if you keep us informed on that, that'll be very interesting, and we've got time to think about it then. Thank you very much. Ken, have you anything you wish to say?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Well, just to thank you very much for the comments you made at the beginning of the meeting. In 2 weeks' time, I will no longer be a county councillor, therefore I can't represent the Worcestershire County Council for you. I don't think the county council has anything special to add, and John Rain and I will both then be free. Is that not quite the right word? But nevertheless, so I wish you luck in the future, and I think the AOMB is in very good hands. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ken. We can then go, James. Have you anything you wish to say?
Yes. Just two things to report. David's already sort of reported that we had a meeting yesterday with Mel Mason about the Pearl Board at Flitillery, and we will be collaborating with him on that project, so it should be very exciting. I'm chairing for Herefordshire a project which is called the Queen's Green Canopy, and it's a project which has just been quietly announced, but the major launch will be next month, and it's to encourage people across the country to plant trees to mark the Queen's Platinum Jubilee next year. So I will alert you, or the office rather, as to what is planned. But basically, we're going to talk to all schools, landowners, churches, every parish really, in Herefordshire, to encourage them to plant either one tree or preferably an avenue or more trees for this. And it ticks lots of boxes, so that I think is a very good thing to be doing. And they will be sort of what you might call acceptable trees for the AONB, I'm sure. And the final thing, just at Eastnor, is we are about to open what was going to be a cafe, but I think now more likely to be described as a kiosk at the entrance in the village to the park, which I hope will attract business, but also take pressure off some other car parking areas and draw more people to our end of the hills. Certainly, we've had a lot of visitors during the last 12 months, many of whom parking on the road and blocking the school, so we're going to open up some parking, and that's all sort of going ahead. And thank I think, David, you've offered to help us with some explanatory interpretation panels and stuff, so thank you.
We have, yeah.
James, thank you. I look forward to hearing more about the Queen's Green Canopy. That sounds an excellent project. Jim, would you like to let us get up to date with what you've got in your area?
Sorry, Chairman, was that me that you were prompting?
Yes, sorry, I beg your pardon.
Yeah, not a great deal from Malvern Hills District Council just at the moment, but I was just going to raise that we now have an officer in post, Matt Barker, who is employed across both Wychhaven and Malvern Hills to mastermind the delivery of the carbon reduction plans. And as you may have picked up, those plans are obviously all about delivering improvements right across both district council areas, which have the potential to impact certainly on the AONB in a very positive way. So lots of initiatives to come forward over the next few years. And we've now got somebody, as I say, dedicated to delivering those and masterminding their delivery, which is good news.
Yes, excellent. We look forward to hearing about that. Rachel, have you got anything you wish to add?
Just to update the meeting, we've taken on a large new nature reserve just east of Evesham, with the subject of tree planting as the focus, really. So it's a former county council small holding site that the Countryside team will be developing over the next few years, with significant amount of tree planting and also creation of pollinator habitats and some wetlands as well. It sits alongside the River Avon. It's a lovely site. It will be the largest site that we actually manage as a Countryside Service. It's about 170 acres. So that's a really exciting new project that we'll be working on.
Thank you. Oh, we've got some really good stuff coming along this time. Now, John is going to... Sarah, have you anything else you wish to add?
Nothing from me.
Thank you very much. And thank you for your contribution. It's always very good to hear what's happening in your neck of the woods. And James, have you anything you wish to say? James Bissett.
Yep, thank you. Just to say that there are various vacant posts within the planning and the built and natural environment teams that are currently on hold, so that it's uncertain when they'll be backfilled, which is all part of the wider budget constraints and the after effects or ongoing effects of the COVID work and commitment the council has put into that. So at the moment, I can't sort of, you know, say when or if, but obviously that will have some knock-on impact into the AONB, both from the planning side of things and the built and natural environment capacity to provide sort of support and input to things. But hopefully there'll be some good news coming forward in the future. But at the moment, it's quite tough times over here, if I'm honest.
Oh dear, sorry about that. Well, we'll hope things will improve in the future. Are there any other queries or questions anyone has to bring up at this meeting? I have to thank you very much for how quickly you have been through everything. Richard wants to say something.
Well, I'm very distressed to find I'm not on the list.
Sorry, did I miss you? I am so sorry. I do beg your pardon. It was not intentional, I promise you.
Most of you, I'm sure you're all aware that the Malvern Hills forms one very large SSSI, SSSI. Natural England came into some money late last year, 2020, and commissioned various organisations to report on the condition of SSIs up and down the country. So the Earth Heritage Trust was contracted to do various SSIs in the West Midlands, including the Morven Hills. So we undertook, despite the fact that it was lockdown, we socially distanced the survey. The great advantage of geology, you see, is that it's in the open space. Geology doesn't grow in the sense that plants do, etc. So we can get on with this stuff. Anyway, we diligently did this. We submitted our report to Natural England. It's been approved. So that is now on their website. And we, in theory, Natural England should be sending to the AOMB office and to Morven Hills Trust, within whose land most of the SSI lies, a copy of the report. So through you, Chair, if I could just ask David or Paul, have you actually received this report yet? No. Okay. Well, it's Natural England.
Morven Hills Trust, I don't think, have received it either.
Clearly, when you see the report, it might help to alleviate us repeating under the AOMB auspices some of those sites that we would normally condition monitor at the appropriate time. We did, it wasn't terribly systematic. There wasn't enough money. Natural England didn't have enough money to do every single quarry. I think we did 15 out of 18, plus two land areas brought down, and I can't remember what the other one was. But clearly, when you get the report, either I or John Payne would wish to talk to you about any future condition monitoring and what the relationship between that is and the work we've just done for directly for Natural England. So we were busy over the winter.
Thank you. And I'm so sorry I missed you out. I do beg your pardon.
I was only teasing, Gwyneth.
It was not intentional, I promise.
No, I'm sure it wasn't.
Thank you very much, all of you, for coming to this meeting. Ken, wishes to say, did you want to say something?
Well, yeah, just a very final comment, really, because Richard had been talking about the Earth Heritage Trust. He'll know that they have displays along the Worcester Way. And one of them was in the corner, the very end, the top of our land in Great Whitley. And it's just been replaced with the good offices of Councillor Kate Andrew from Aberley Parish Council and some money from Aberley and from Great Whitley. And I just wanted to point out to you that behind my head here is a painting of the elms on the hill where we used to live by my wife. And I think that's very important. I should let you know that. Those are the elms that have survived all the problems with elms. And it was a wonderful place to be. And I'm very pleased that the Worcester Way Earth Heritage Trust has actually managed to replace some of the displays and do a very good job. Well done, Richard. That was my last chance to say anything like that. So just thought I might get that in quickly.
Very nice. Thank you, Ken. I had nothing to do with it. Thank you.
Thank you all very much. I promised that we would try not to make this meeting too long, and I do hope that you have had a chance to say everything you wish to say, and I haven't rushed you through this. All I have to say now is that our next meeting will be on the 5th of November 2021 at a venue to be confirmed, and hopefully we can meet face to face. Until then, thank you very much for your contributions today.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Well done, everybody. Thank you very much.